Next, we talk about how we can describe an algorithm. And as we have seen, there are only those three constructs that we have to talk about, and then you can build all algorithms. Isn't that fantastic? So, when we try to write down or formulate and describe an algorithm, it's clear that we have to think about some kind of notation. Because ultimately what you want to do, you want to share the algorithms and be able to understand algorithms that someone else has written down. So this kind of understanding and sharing is a key aspect in this type of notations, okay, that we will see. Well, then next, there are various ways that you can express an algorithm. You can think about it as a textual problem. So you use natural language, right? I can define, for example, my cookbook. I write down some text, how this has to be done. So we can use pseudocode. And finally, we can use programming languages, which is, of course, wonderful. We have graphical ways, for example, flowcharts to specify an algorithm. So the quality of this representation differs. It's clear, though, that we must have our key properties of algorithms, which is definiteness, effectiveness, and finiteness. But like I said, the understandability and standardization of those formulations are so important that we must pay close attention. So let's have a look in all those different representations and let's get started with the natural language. Recipes are more or less a standardized description. I put down one here, right? Hummus and tomato pasta. You see some ingredients and some steps. We come back to that in a moment and discuss it. Next, we have pseudocode. Pseudo means pretending or something that is false. So it's not really code here. It's false code here, which means it's kind of like computer code, but also closer to our natural language a little bit than a real programming language. Okay? Typically, pseudocode uses constructs of programming languages. It's not standardized. It's semi-formal representation of an algorithm. And there are many forms of pseudocode. Some are closer to programming languages and some are closer to natural language. So here's an example of pseudocode, in fact, two examples. How to start a car. We see here the individual steps. So it's line 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on, which means we do this first, then we do this. So we have our sequence. Next, we have our iteration construct here, repeat while, and our decision-making construct here is if, then, and end if, basically means everything here should be done if the condition here holds. So let's get through this algorithm. So we want to start a car, so we insert a key in ignition, we turn the key to start position, and then we repeat as long as the engine hasn't started, we hold the key in start position. So yeah, dun 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 dun, right? So then we wait and we check if 6 seconds has passed while we hold the key in the start position, then we turn the key to off position because the car obviously, well, in this case, it may not have started. Then we wait 10 seconds and turn the key to on position. And here is a slightly different formulation of this. Basically, they say the same. We use different keywords here. Note that some aspects, some actions here are a bit vague, right? So hold the key in start position. And what does 6 seconds have passed mean, right? And a lot of questions. And we'll look at this example and discuss it in a couple of minutes. So let's talk about our pseudocode, our algorithm about hummus and tomato pasta. Well, we can formulate this closer to programming as this here, right? We say this is a recipe, hummus and tomato pasta. And then we define tools to use. We say we need a saucepan, a frying pan, a kettle. And then we define the ingredients as what we later will learn as variables. So we have a dishes, various dishes, which are our input ingredients. Okay. And then we say the kettle is filled with water. We heat the kettle until it boils and so on and so forth. We heat pan one with a high temperature for 2 minutes, right? And so on. And we see some comments already here, make the sauce. And finally, you want to serve here. Well, and So we can discuss this example later, but basically there are many ways of representing the pseudocode. So now we would start normally with some group work in the lecture hall. I ask you to instead use a little bit the Teams chat with your colleagues to do some think, pair, share group work, okay? Normally this works as follows. Well, you should think about the task for a little bit and then discuss it with your neighbor, okay? You can do this again in Teams. And then finally, we should share and discuss this in the whole class. We'll do this a little bit in our exercises, okay? And typically we have a time limit for those tasks. So think about it and pause the video again. So group work one, let's look at now our hummus and tomato pasta. Well, is this actually a good description for an algorithm? So think about these requirements that we talked for algorithms. Definiteness, effectiveness, and finiteness, right? Here with the questions. Once you've done that, think about how understandable is this for you? And a very simple question that typically comes in mind is, can you execute this algorithm? Right? Can you create this hummus or no tomato pasta following these steps? Right? And take about 3 minutes for that, and please pause the video now. Here is a potential answer to this question. It doesn't have to be complete, but here are some thoughts that I have when I go through this little recipe. So first of all, well, we know that this is hummus and tomato pasta and it serves two. So that is kind of the output of this algorithm when we run it. We also know a little bit about the performance of the algorithm by knowing that it's a quick 20 minutes after work dash. Really useful, particularly when you are single, to know how long it would run, right? How long do you need to prepare your meal? Well, 20 minutes, really nice. So that's already, I think, an instance where you know, where you learn why performance of an algorithm does matter, right, to you. Good, next we know the ingredients, which are kind of the input. So then we have the steps, which is finally the algorithm. It talks about step-by-step procedure, right? It walks us through how we get from this input to the ingredients to this output, which is hummus and tomato pasta, right? So we look through these steps and we have to talk about definiteness, effectiveness, and finiteness, right? So in effectiveness net, for instance, we have to ask ourselves, is each step basic enough and can be executed in practice? So add the pasta to a large pan, okay? And at this step, you can wonder, how big must this pan be? What does large mean, okay? So, well, I can say in this case, it's clear because it means the pasta must fit into it, right? Good. So then we go in step two. Well, fry the cumin into olive oil for 2 minutes. And at this point, you may wonder, in which pan actually? Right, we don't know what we need here, what kind of pans we need. We just know that, well, this has to be done somehow. Then we have to stir in the tomatoes and the hummus. And at this stage, I wonder, is it necessary to add them into the cumin that we add, you know, in the olive oil that we had there? Well, it might not be totally clear. I'm a newbie to cooking a bit. So I sometimes confuse those instructions. I find them not precisely enough, right? So they are not precisely enough defined. So that means it's not well defined. So, and we leave them to simmer until done. Well, this is now really a tough instruction, because when do we know when it's done? Well, expert cooks may know that, but I certainly struggle with this instruction. So we need to define this further, what it would mean to be done. And finally it says, serve the pasta and add the sauce. Well, yeah, some further questions. Of course, you can have your own thoughts about these issues and this recipe, but these are just some thoughts that give you some idea how I would look at it. Good. Now we will have a look at a little video that shows the literal execution of instructions for making a peanut butter jelly sandwich. So, and as you will see, it can be really hard to write down algorithms, and I ask you to, you know, if you're interested, to watch this video to the full length, but I will have a look for 30 seconds into this little video.
You can write down some instructions and teach me how to make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich?
Yeah.
Then do it.
I knew we were gonna do this. I heard Dad talking to Mom.
Choke yourself on my hand. Sometimes they do what you tell them.
Dad, I'm done.
Step one, get two pieces of bread out.
Got them.
Get a butter knife and get some PB. Take one piece of bread, spread it around with the butter knife.
No, Dad, with the peanut butter.
I'm just doing what it says. It says, take one piece of bread, spread it around with the butter knife.
Hold on.
Get some jelly, rub it on the other half of the bread.
No, Dad, open the jelly.
Well, it doesn't say to do that. Put the breads together on top of each other. Take a big bite. This doesn't taste like a peanut butter jelly sandwich.
Well, yeah, of course this video goes longer, but I hope you can see that it's not always easy to give instructions that can be shared with others and communicated and will be well understood, received, and actually can be followed, right? If you work with your own kids or with your family, sometimes it's really